بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Hi dear third year medical students, we will discuss today energy. It is an important subject. First of all, what's energy? Energy is the ability to perform work and to maintain our life, because our life need energy. And energy exists in many forms, like mechanical, chemical, electrical, light and nuclear energy, and in heat. The law of thermodynamics, it said that we can convert one type of this energy to another type. And in our body, chemical energy is converted from food, which is a chemical energy, to mechanical energy and production of heat. The major dietary source are the carbohydrate, fat and the protein. So what's calorie? It is a basic unit of energy. And it is the amount of heat or energy required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree centigrade at a standard temperature. This is the definition. Because calorie is a very small unit, we will substitute it by the kilocalories. It is equals to 1000 calorie. And by definition, it is the amount of heat energy required to raise a temperature of kilogram of water 1 degree centigrade. What's joule? Joule is the work that is done when 1 kilogram is moved 1 meter by a force of 1 newton. These are definitions. So the total content of the food measured by certain measure or by certain device, we call it the calorimeter. We have weapon calorimeter, المسعر. It is designed to burn food. The amount of energy produced per gram of a protein and fat or carbohydrate by pump calorimeter are: each one of a protein, 1 gram of a protein will produce energy of 4 kilocalorie, and 1 gram of fat produce 9 kilocalorie, carbohydrate 4 kilocalorie, and alcohol 7 kilocalorie. But this is not a nutrient. The nutrients are protein, fat, carbohydrate. And the nutrient release energy when they are catabolized. Catabolism of food produces CO2 and water, and this release energy, and the energy catch within the ATPase. ATPase is the fuel of all energy requiring a process in our body. And there is usually the food content of a protein, fat, carbohydrate are taken from the tables, as you see here. For example, 2 eggs will provide us with 100 grams. 100 grams, these are distributed in 30% protein, 12% is fat, and 1% is carbohydrate. And as we said, each gram of protein will produce 4 kilocalories, so the total of calories is 52 kilocalories. And each gram of fat will produce 9 kilocalories. So multiply the content, which is 12 by 9, and equals to 108 kilocalories. And the same for each carbohydrate gram will produce 4 kilocalories, and by multiplication of 1 by 4, the result is 4 kilocalories. The total calorie is 164. The same for the bread, you applied it, and the same for milk. Milk composition, 3.5% is a protein and 3.5% fat, and only 5% is carbohydrate. So it is main constituent is fat and protein. And also by multiplication by the calorie expenditure for each gram, the result is 65.5 kilocalories. We have to remember that the cup of milk contains 200 cc and it equals to 200 grams. While 1 tablespoonful equals to 15 gram or 15 cc. 1 tablespoonful is 5 gram or 15 cc. But you have to remember that oil, if it is a teaspoonful, tea, as we said, it is only 5 grams. 5 grams multiplied by the energy production, it is 9 kilocalorie for 1 gram. So each 1 teaspoonful will produce 45 kilocalorie of oil, and sugar will produce 20 kilocalorie. Okay, now what do you mean by aerobic and anaerobic pathway? First of all, when you do exercise, you need energy, and this energy taken from the content of nutrient inside your body and stored as a glycogen is a source of sugar, as fat it is also fat, fatty adipose tissue it is a source of fat, and protein in the muscles. So in the first 1 and 2 minutes of exercise, oxygen not arrived to the muscle. That is anaerobic because there is no oxygen given to the muscle. Energy must come down from anaerobic sources. So after several minutes, here oxygen will be provided to the muscle. We call it the aerobic pathway. The aerobic pathway take over and all exercise continue. There is a constant interchange or use of energy source. Now it will depend on the intensity and length of exercise and the patient fitness or the person fitness if he is not a patient and food eaten. And we have to divide the activity or the intensity and the duration into 3 categories. If it is short term and high intensity activity as in running, usually they rely mostly on the anaerobic pathway. Only carbohydrate is here from the glycogen can be used if it is only running, although it is short term. You have to remember that it is short term. For short term, only the carbohydrate is used to produce energy. If it is of low to moderate intensity and exercise is continue, so supported by aerobic, and here both carbohydrate and fat are utilized. And fat are an important energy source during exercise because the fatty acids are abundant, means it is many in our body, a huge in number, and they're using them to spare the muscle glycogen breakdown. And they use it to prevent feeling of tiredness and pain in the muscle. While on long-term activity, the fat become the primary source of energy. So if it is low in severity and short duration maybe, so fat is not going to break, only the carbohydrate used for energy. So as we said, it is anaerobic in early stage. But if it is intermediate intensity and the duration is more longer, fat and carbohydrate will be used to produce energy. If it is long term activity for long time, the fat here will become the primary source of energy, and we call it the aerobic. So a sedentary person, those who have sedentary lifestyle, they break down glycogen faster, and lactic acid will accumulate after giving exercise. There is muscle fatigue and weakness, and there is pain in the muscle. But a physically fit person, they have higher aerobic capacity, and they lose more fat than glycogen. What is the total energy requirement? This depends on the summation of the 3 factors. Really, it is 4 factors, but the most important is the first 3 factors. They include basal metabolic rate, the physical activity, and the thermic effect of food. Basal metabolic rate, here we have to discuss. Let us say that other factors also affect the energy requirement, like growth, pregnancy, lactation, and temperature regulation, but it has a lesser value or a less extent value. Now about the energy requirement, the basal metabolic rate and physical activity, and as we said, the thermal effect of food, these are together will produce the total energy requirement. Basal metabolic rate, it's equal to a resting metabolic state or rate. Here the minimum amount of energy needed by the body at rest and in a fasting state and post-absorptive state. So the patient minimum amount of energy needed at rest and after a period of 12 hours of starvation, when there is a post-absorptive state, this is needed to maintain life process. The basal energy is measured by the basal metabolic rate by 2 ways, by the direct and indirect calorimeter. This picture shows the indirect calorimeter, and this one is the direct, by putting the patient in a specific chamber and check the amount of the basal metabolic rate. So when you start this test on any person, first of all, the patient should be at complete physical and mental rest, relaxed, not asleep, at least 12 hours fasting after meal and several hours after active exercise and in a comfortable temperature and comfortable environment. These are the important measures before checking the basal metabolic rate. And here, what are the factors that affect the basal metabolic rate? First of all, surface area. The more taller the person, the more surface area and the more basal metabolic rate. Gender. Male have a higher metabolic rate than female by 5 to 10%. And the basal metabolic rate higher in children than elderly because of rapid growth. And it is higher in puberty than adolescent. And basal metabolic rate decreases by 2% for each decade of life, for each 10 years of life. And this is due to fat accumulation and reduction in body mass. What other factors affect the basal metabolic rate? It is the endocrine, mainly it is the thyroid gland hormone. And in hypothyroidism, there is reduction and there is an increasing in weight and edema, reduction in basal metabolic rate by 30 to 50%. While in hyperthyroidism, there is decreasing body weight as the body as it is increases by 50 to 75% basal metabolic rate. The growth hormone also it increases basal metabolic rate by 20%. Sympathetic stimulation also increases, like strain, like stress, after exercise and after surgery and even after emotion. There is a fluctuation of sex hormone. It has a fluctuation effect on the basal metabolic rate during menstrual cycle. For example, at mid-cycle it decreases, while it increases in post-ovulation by 7.7%. Also, body composition, it is more in the muscular tissue than other tissue, so it is more in basal metabolic rate higher in male because he is of higher muscle mass. Pregnancy affects the basal metabolic rate as it increases by 20%, especially in the third trimester due to heavy weight and head tightness and due to hormonal effect. Other is we talk about primary, and now we'll talk about the secondary factors. First of all is a nutritional state. If there is severe malnutrition and prolonged starvation, the basal metabolic rate will decrease by 50%. This is an adaptive mechanism to consume energy. And heat also it affects, as we said in the beginning, to maintain heat because of malabsorption, they are liable to have hypothermia. Sleep, it decreases the basal metabolic rate by 10%. Fever. Fever increases the basal metabolic rate by 13% for each 1 degree centigrade above 37 degree body temperature. So if there is infection, they usually have increased basal metabolic rate by 13% for each elevation, 1 degree elevation of temperature. Muscle tone in athletes, and there is an increased muscle tone and increased basal metabolic rate because of an increased oxygen consumption during muscle contraction. And climate, there is decrease. If there is decrease in climate temperature, so there is an increase in heat loss, and this will increase the basal metabolic rate by 5% for each 10 degree reduction in temperature. For example, in Eskimo, there is reduction in temperature, but at the same time there is an increase in basal metabolic rate to increase heat production and compensate for this cold weather. While in other area, in Africa, where the temperature is high, there is reduction in basal metabolic rate to decrease the production of heat. Here we have to remember that the basal energy expenditure is an increase in cold, in hot environment, and this is due to sweating. This will increase the basal energy expenditure. How to calculate the energy requirement of basal metabolic rate from the ideal body weight? First of all, we have to know the ideal body weight. And we have certain formula used for male and female. In male, we use the ideal body weight per kilograms multiplied by 1 kilocalorie for each kilogram per hour and multiplied by the 24 hours of day. In female, we use the same which is the ideal body weight multiplied by 0.95 kilocalorie per kg per hour multiplied by 24 hours through the day. These are the basal metabolic rate. First of all, we have to estimate it. Second, we have to check the physical activity, which is equals to the basal metabolic rate multiplied by the activity factor. Activity factor, we have a classification of activity factor depending on the patient physical activity through day. So if they are of light activity, which means sedentary life style, 30% is the basal metabolic rate is required. Like office worker, lawyers, doctors, teachers, shop workers, and house cleaning. These activities are of light activities. And moderate activity, it requires 50% of the basal metabolic rate, like industrial workers, farmers, students, soldier but not in active service, housewife, and carrying a load, cycling. These are moderate activity. We have heavy activity, which it is equals to 75 to 100% of the basal metabolic rate, like agriculture worker, unskilled laborer, this is the unskilled laborer, and minor workers, and soldier in active service and walking in a load uphill. So note, we have to note that mentally active does not appreciably affect the energy requirement. Those who use their brain in the working, they are not use energy a lot and not use as energy expenditure. So this table, although it is not so important, but we have to remember that light activity, as we said, they will lose, if it's a male, will lose 1.5 activity factor. This is what we call the activity factor. We did it in the formula to calculate the amount required as energy for 24 hours. In female, it is 1.5. If it is moderate male, it is 1.7. In female, 1.6. And very active, more than 2.1. In male, more than 1.9 in female. And the type of activity, whether sleeping, lying, office working, and walking slowly, laboring. So these are the activity factor for each type of work. And this is another. This is a physical activity pyramid, level 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And this is an example of activity. Whenever there is less vigorous and more time, they lose less expenditure, and more vigorous and less time, they need more expenditure activity. Now, specific dynamic action of food, or we call it the thermic effect of food. This is an extra energy released due to ingestion, absorption, metabolism of food reaches its maximum level by 3 to 5 hours after ingestion of food. So this is the thermic effect of food. It will produce another or extra energy. So the extra energy effect produced by eating protein, it is 25 to 30% of the basal metabolic rate. Carbohydrate will produce energy about 6% of the basal metabolic rate, while the fat 4% of the basal metabolic rate. If a patient or a person take mixed type of food, the total or the thermic effect of food, it equals to 10% of the basal metabolic rate. We have an example here. How to calculate the total energy requirement of a fourth year medical student, male student, whose the ideal body weight is 60 kilograms. This is an important question. As he is a student, he is a moderately active male. 1.7 is the activity factor. So we want to check the total energy requirement. It is equal to physical activity plus the, as we said, the total energy or the total effect of food. Physical activity is the basal metabolic rate and rest multiplied by the activity level. So we have to calculate the basal metabolic activity for male. It is the body weight multiplying by 1 kilocalorie for kg per hour and multiplied by 24 hours. And then this is the amount. this amount is important to know the basal metabolic rate. It will be multiplied by the activity factor, which is 1.7, and the result here is for the physical activity. So how to calculate the total effect of food, the energy production by taking food, depending on the type of food, as it is mixed type, so it is only 10%. And here we have to multiply the 10% by the basal metabolic rate. It is, and basal metabolic rate in this example, as you see here, it was this number, 1440, and the total energy or effect of food, it was 144. We have to sum these two figures, and by summation the end is result is 2588 kilocalorie per day. You have to know how to prepare and how to calculate. So other factors, as we said, it is a growth, pregnancy, lactation. The growth also, additional energy is required to cover the cost of increasing weight and height. So a growing infant, usually they store 12 to 15% of energy. Why? For growth and formation of new tissue. And as the child goes older, the rate is diminished. The rate of growth is diminished, and the calorie requirement also is reduced. Okay, so when in younger age group, the rate of growth is rapid, and the store of energy is more. It's 12 to 15%. While with increasing age, the rate of growth decreasing and the energy needed is less, but the total energy requirement is increased because of increasing body mass. Okay, increasing body mass. And here we have the amount of according to age and the energy required. As you see, as the patient is young, the energy is needed in high amount. For example, in the first 4 months, he needs about 180 kilocalorie per kg. And it decreasing with age, and in adulthood, they reach about 55. For female, is 47 kilocalorie per kg. And for adult, as we said, more than up to 18 years, it is 45 in male and 40 in female. Pregnancy and lactation. It is additional calorie required to meet the energy cost of a pregnancy. So if she is in the third trimester and she is pregnant, she needs another 300 kilocalorie per day to maintain her pregnancy, and for lactation she needs another 500 kilocalorie per day to maintain lactation. Now we have an example. You have to calculate the total energy requirement of 60 kilograms housewife woman. First of all, we have to check the basal metabolic rate, and it is estimated here, as we said below. A physical activity is the basal metabolic rate multiplied by 1.6, that is housewife, and we have the physical activity result. And the total energy of food is 10% multiplied by the basal metabolic rate, and here is the result. So if she is pregnant, we have to add another 300 kilocalorie, and if she lactating, we have to add 500 kilocalorie per day, and we have to calculate this all together, physical activity and the total energy of food, giving the total requirement. Now the recommended intake or daily allowance, they are levels of intake of essential nutrients they consider to be adequate to meet the non-nutritional need of particularly all healthy person. So it is the intake or nutritional intake, the essential intake that maintain our life, depending on the age, sex, type of activity, physiological need, if it's she is a pregnant or lactating woman, and depending on the growth status, as mature baby, premature baby, or during adolescence or early childhood, and also on pathological state, whether the patient have hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, or if there is infection and fever, or liable to accident or stressful event. So this is the recommended daily intake. Why it is important? They uses interpretation of food consumption records, evaluation of food supply for certain groups of individuals, planning and buying food supply for a group of people. So it is important to know, because you have to interrupt your consumption. How much you take of certain type of food, it is over or under requirement. And as we said, evaluation of food supply for a certain group of individuals, probably those with hypertension, they need to decrease the amount of protein or fat and cholesterol mainly. So you have to estimate the amount and the recorded amount. And planning and buying food supply for a group, probably elderly group, they need a special type of food, they need type of food which is contain cereals and decrease amount of fat and protein, and maybe athletics, and they need higher amount of protein. So depending on the requirement of each group and on the activity, and as we said, on the age, and establish guide for public health program to decrease for example obesity. So they need special health program to decrease intake of certain type of food that increase obesity, and develop a new food project. And this important to know that the content of food project, the daily allowance requirement should not exceeding this daily allowance requirement. Setting guidance for nutrition labeling of food. This is a guideline for nutrition label. It is important to put a label on each can or type of food to let the patient or the customer to know what are the content and what's the amount present, not to exceed their daily allowance. And developing a nutritional education program. This is important to know by certain educational program for healthy state and for treatment of certain diseases, and each one has its important constituent advantages. So the recommended intake, is there any limitation? There are some conditions that recommended intake do not cover the body need. Sometimes the patient have inborn error of metabolism. They need to omit some types of food and add another type. And maybe in chronic diseases like those with a chronic renal disease, with a chronic liver disease, they need a special type of food. And we will replace one instead of another. We omit some type of food and replace by another type, according to the patient condition. As in probably diabetic patient, we have to decrease or to omit the amount of sugar and replace by starch, carbohydrate, but in a small and allowed recommended doses. Special diet required by certain indication, like in post-operative care and liver disease, there are special diet for each of these, and others also, other examples. Infection, as we said, infection, if there is fever, there is an increase the requirement, and we have to exceed this recommended intake. And in a premature birth, also they increase requirement as they grow rapidly and they need more doses or more amount of proteins and other nutrients to maintain their normal growth and normal life. And for example, for a protein intake, it is consists about 12 to 15% of total calorie intake. An adult 0.80 gram for each kilogram body weight, and which is about 56 grams per day of a protein. For a 70 kilogram man, about 44 per day, and for 55 kilogram women. So it is different according to age, and we have to know that it depends on the body weight. In children, there is additional need for a protein. As we said, additional 35% of total calorie intake should be in protein. So in adult, it is only 12 to 15% of calorie intake is a protein. In children, we have to add another 55%, and it is as the following. In infant, 2.2 gram per kg per day of insulin of protein, sorry, is required. If the patient is between 6 months to 12 months, it is equal to 1 year of age, the requirement is 1.6. For early childhood requirement before the age of 4 years, between 1 and 3 years, it is 1.2. Between 4 and 6 years, it is 1.1. And later childhood, it is equals to 1 gram per kg per day. And as we said, in adult, it is only 0.80 gram per kg per day. So to calculate the amount of a protein required, we have to multiply the weight by 0.80 gram as an adult of a protein. And the same is applied for carbohydrate. It is source of energy and about 50 to 60% of total calorie intake. If the patient or anyone take mixed food, the only carbohydrate in diet to produce sodium retention and associated water retention. So there is no specific recommended intake in carbohydrate, but should not less than 50 to 1 gram of digestible carbohydrate per day. There is no specific recommended intake, but should be less than 50 or 100 gram of digestible carbohydrate. If the daily intake is less than 50, they lead to ketosis and electrolyte loss. This is a very important subject to remember here. If the daily intake less than 50 gram, lead to ketosis and electrolyte loss. So how to calculate the need of carbohydrate recommended intake? We multiply the amount of total calorie, should be 50 to 60, should be carbohydrate, multiply by the total calorie intake, and then this result will divide it by 4, as each 1 gram of carbohydrate would supply by 4 kilocalorie. And then 60% multiplying by 2500 kilocalorie, this the end or the result is divided by 4, and the end result is 375 calorie. Now what about fat? Fat should be not more than 30% of total energy. And how to calculate? We multiply 30 by the total calorie intake and then divide it by 9, as it is a 9 kilocalorie for each gram of fat, and the result will be the grams of fat per day. For example, if we have 30% of the total calorie when it is 2500 kilocalorie, the result is 750 kilocalorie of fat, and this is subdivided over 9, and the result is 83 gram per day of fat is required. What do you mean by adequate diet? It is a balanced diet. That is the diet composed of various nutrients the body needs for maintenance and repair and living process of the growth and development in children, and it needs to meet all the nutritional and energy requirement of person. So it should contain protein, carbohydrate, fat, vitamins, minerals, fibers, and waters. The percentage of various nutrient to the total calorie intake has the following. Protein is 10 to 20% of the total calorie is from protein. Fat, 20 to 30% of total calorie is from fat. Carbohydrate, as we said, 50 to 60% of total calorie from carbohydrate, and according to the food guide pyramid. We have to remember that this important point, the intake, more than two-thirds of the recommended intake of a nutrient are considered adequate. If it is more than two-thirds of the recommended intake. Thank you.